And I am looking forward to exciting you about the work I do in my own lab, namely quantum mechanics and quantum computation. So quantum theory is the physics behind almost everything, almost every technology that makes the modern world the way it is today. For example, the laptops and cell phones, which all of us use every day, lasers, right, the one right now I have in my hand, LEDs or light emitting diodes, which are used in TVs and laptop screens and other light sources, MRI machines, magnetic resonance imaging, which are used to scan human body, used to image human body parts, all are based on quantum theories. So today, I'll take you deep into the world of quantum physics, and we'll try to understand how things behave in that quantum world. Then I'll talk about what can I do using those properties to build something called a very powerful machinery, the so-called quantum computer. So all right, let's begin. So since I talk about quantum physics, let me ask some of you, you must have heard the word quantum mechanics. Can anyone tell me what do you mean by that? Anyone? Yes?
The study of the quantum world, the mechanics in the quantum world.
What do you mean by quantum world?
The small world.
Yeah.
Indivisible.
Sorry?
Indivisible.
Yeah, so kind of correct. So essentially, quantum physics governs the behavior of particles at very small scale. How small? At the level of atoms, and even smaller. So how did all this begin? Did it begin just by a crazy idea by a smart scientist? Actually, no. It started with a light bulb. In 1890, an American inventor named Thomas Alva Edison invented practical light bulbs, which were reliable and long-lasting. Here you see image of four bulbs at that time. And he wanted to start a business with that. Since he wanted to commercialize his bulbs, he wanted to make better bulbs. By better, I mean maximum light output with using minimum amount of electricity, which in turn means minimum cost. And for this job, a German theorist named Max Planck was hired. So since the problem is related to light bulb, let's first talk about light. Can anyone tell me what light is? Anyone? What is light? Yes? Yeah, that's correct. So the basic idea is light is a wave. And all of us know about waves, right? You know what are waves. If you throw a stone in the pond, you'll see ripples going outwards, like one I have shown here. So if you take now a cross section along the diameter, you'll see a pattern like this. So the peak is called crest, and the dip is called trough. And the length between two peaks is called wavelength of that wave. And that is what characterizes the waves. This kind of waves need some medium to propagate. For water waves, you need water. Sound is another example for which you need air, like I am talking right now, or you can have some solid medium as well to transmit. But there is a different class of waves, which are called electromagnetic waves. They don't need any medium to propagate. That means they can travel in free space. That's why light from the sun can come in the earth while traversing a very vast, empty space. But sound from sun cannot come to earth. So now the question is, we understand light. What about light of different colors? What is the difference between different colors? So as I mentioned, wavelength is the characterization of light. So different colors have different wavelengths. For example, red color have a longer wavelength, and as you go towards orange, yellow, green, blue, and violet, the wavelength gradually reduces. If you want to have a feeling about how small the sizes are, these wavelengths are, consider the green light, and the wavelength of a green light is about 200 times smaller than the width of a human ear. So it's very small. Now the question is, what about lights of wavelengths which have which are larger than red light or have wavelength smaller than the blue light. Can you not tell me what about those lights? Yeah, that's correct. You know quite a lot. So there is actually a whole bunch of spectrum in the electromagnetic waves, and the visible light which we see using our eyes is a very small part of that. So if you increase the length, wavelength beyond red, you will see infrared rays, which is heat, then microwaves, which we use in our cell phones and microwave ovens, FM, which are used to catch the radio stations, etc. On the other hand, if you reduce the size of the wavelength, you will enter into the ultraviolet rays, then X-rays, and so on. So now that we know what light is, let's go back to our problem of light bulb. What was known already in those days that when you heat up an object and increase its temperature, it changes its color. For example, if you start from, let's say, 200, hitting an object at 200 degrees Celsius, it will look dark. But you can feel the infrared radiation as heat from that object. If you increase the temperature to 1,000 degrees, it will look bright red. At 3,000 degrees, it will look orange. At 4,400, it will be bright yellow. And at 5,200, well, I can't say it. It's a white light. The background is white. That's why you can't see it. If you keep increasing the temperature further, it will turn towards the blue side. You'll initially see sky, blue, or it all looks violet, but it's blue and darker blue, and it keeps going on. It will always have a bluish tint as you keep increasing the temperature. You see it's 20,000 degrees Celsius. So the point is, although it looks like at different temperature, the color of the object is different, but it doesn't mean that, let's say at 3,000 degrees, this object is emitting only orange color. Actually, it emits all the colors, and it's the combined effect we see using our eyes which gives rise to this color. So the question is, when you heat up an object, how much light is radiated at different colors? Or what is the proportion of light radiated at different wavelengths? So in this plot, I'm trying to explain that. So in the x-axis, I have different colors. The first one is ultraviolet ray, which you can't see using your eyes. Then the visible spectrum, namely the VIP gear. Then brown, and again, these black boxes are the infrared rays, which again, you can't see using your eyes. So, and on the y-axis, you have relative proportions of these lights emitted. So when an object reaches 1,000 degrees Celsius, you see very little bit amount of light is coming in the blue part, some amount in the yellow part, and mostly in the red part. And there is a lot of energy coming in the infrared part. Because most of the light is in the red part, we perceive this object as red. Now we increase the temperature. The whole distribution shifts toward left. You see, it was here, then it shifted towards left. Now the temperature of the object is 3,000 degrees Celsius. And now you see there is quite a lot of light coming in the blue and green part, that this the combined color looks like orange. At 5,200 degrees Celsius, there's quite a lot of light coming in the visible spectrum, and it looks like white. By the way, our sun's temperature is about 5,500 degrees Celsius. So although I have shown here discrete colors, light don't come in discrete. They are actually continuous. You can smoothly change from blue to red in a continuous form. So we should really talk about this kind of smooth curves. So this essentially tells you the distribution of light at different wavelengths. Okay? So the problem of light bulb is, basically you want to design a light bulb which will emit most of the light in this visible spectrum and not in the infrared rays. Because you can't see those infrared rays, and essentially those energy are wasted. We can. All right. So the job of Max Planck was to understand this phenomena. What I am showing you are the experimentally obtained curves, the distribution of different colors when you heat up an object, and Max Planck had to understand that. what were already known at that time, the theories which were already known, if you apply those theories using one approach, you would find this kind of curve, which kind of matches in this small wavelength part, but doesn't match in the mid wavelength and long wavelength part. On the other hand, if you would use another approach, you will get this kind of curve, which matches quite well in the long wavelength part, but doesn't match in the middle and small wavelength part. So that was the problem he faced. He tried for 3 to 4 years to solve this problem and failed. So that's what often happens in research. You are stuck in a problem for years, and then you finally come up with a revolutionary idea. So finally, after 3 to 4 years, he fed up and said, well, let's forget all the physics I have learned till now. I'll just try to find the mathematical expression which gives rise to this curve. And aha, he found the formula. When he forgot all the physics he had learned, he found the formula, and here it is. Well, this is not quite exactly the formula. The exact formula looks slightly complicated and not important for this talk. So the point is, he found a formula which explains the experimentally observed curves, but he had no clue where did it come from. So he said, well, let's say that what the formula I found is correct, and then what should the underlying principle be so that which gives rise to this formula? And what he found was completely bizarre. So as I mentioned, we know lights are electromagnetic waves, and we think those to be continuous. They carry continuous amount of energy. But his theory predicted that light cannot be continuous. It has to come in particles, kind of lumps. And those has to carry discrete amount of energies. So if I say this part contains 1 unit of energy, it can have 1 unit or 2 unit and 3 unit, and so on. It cannot have 1.75 units of energy. And this is completely bizarre. I mean, no one had previously thought about this. I mean, they used to think light is continuous, but they sounds like there are now packets of light. And this thing is called quantization of energy, because energy is no longer continuous. It comes in packets, and that is why it's called energy is quantized. I'll try to explain giving an analogy. So you know, in old days, there used to be this milkman which used to come to your home and deliver milk. They used to come using big jars, and you could ask, can I have 1.75 liters of milk, please? They would say, sure, why not? They used to have with them different sizes of mugs, and using that, they will give you exactly 1.75 liters. But nowadays, we go to supermarket, and we have packets of water, packets of milk, let's say in 1 liter of packet. So if you now ask, can I have 1.75 liters, the shopkeeper will say, sorry, we don't sell in those units, we only sell in units of 1 liter. So you have to either buy 1 liter or 2 liter, and so on. So this is essentially the idea of discretization, from continuous form to discrete form. So let's come back to Planck's theory. So he said lights come in lumps or packets. Each color light of different colors have different sizes. So what I mean by that, these blue packets of light have some amount of energy. Then this white, green packet of light have a different amount of energy. But still, those are also packets. And similarly for other wavelengths. These packets of light are called photons. Let me try to give you an idea about how small these photons are. What I am showing you here are few rice grains. Do you have any idea how much energy does one rice grain contain? Anyone? How much energy is contained in one single rice grain? Any guess? You know, right? You buy juice packets, it's written there like 20 kilocalories and so on. Yes? You can use, but that's a different state. That means if you want to destroy the whole rice and convert everything into energy, how much energy is that? I'm not talking about that amount of energy. I am talking if you consume one rice grain, how much energy you obtain. Okay, it's about 70 calories. It's a pretty small number. So if you now ask the question, how many blue photons do you need to have an energy equal to 70 calories or equal to one rice grain? It turns out to be 600 billion billion blue photons. So now you see it's how small these packets are. They are very, very tiny. And that's why they are insignificant to our daily life. If you want to have another feel about this number, each heartbeat of our heart takes about 0.25 calorie of energy. And still, one photon, you will need like about 20 billion billion photons to have that amount of energy. So the point is, they are very small, but still lights come in lumps. They have a behavior of particles. So as I mentioned, this theory was given by Max Planck in 1900. And the interesting part is that the idea is so different, he himself didn't believe in it. He said it must be some mathematical construction which explained the phenomena, and the actual physics must be different. Of course, he himself didn't believe it. No one took that theory seriously. Until this famous scientist, who is he? Yeah, so all of you know, Albert Einstein. In 1905, 5 years later, used the theory of Max Planck to explain another phenomena, which was still unsolved in that time. It is called the photoelectric effect. It's a very simple thing. So whenever you shine a light on a piece of metal, electrons are ejected out. Okay? But it was unexplained using the theories they already had in that time. What Einstein proposed, he took the idea of Max Planck and said, let's now consider lights as particles. So if the photons have energy greater than that of electron, it will come and kick off the electron. But if the energy is less, it will not be able to. So the explanation was very simple using the Max Planck's idea. And in fact, that explanation led to Nobel Prize in 1921. By the way, Max Planck also got Nobel Prize in 1918. So you see, a revolutionary idea gave two Nobel Prizes, and there are many more following in later years. So the essential idea of this part is that energy is quantized, light comes in packets, which are called photons, and light behaves like particles. So we saw one way, light behaves like particles. What about the reverse? What about can the particles also behave like waves? So we'll do another thought experiment to understand that part. So before going to that experiment, let's first try to understand what do we mean by wave or particle. What is the experiment you should do to say that something is behaving like a wave or something is behaving like a particle? Here I show you a few images. All of this should be quite familiar to you. Can anyone tell me what this is? Yeah, soap bubble, showing various colors. This one? Yeah, if you open the doors by a very small amount, there's a narrow constriction and light shows this kind of behavior. And this one? Yeah, oil split on water. In rainy days, you usually see it outside on the road. So all these are wave phenomena which can be explained by a single phenomena called interference. So it's very easy to understand interference. For example, consider two waves which meet with each other such a way that the crests meet with crest and troughs meet with troughs. What will happen, we'll add this up, you'll get another wave with larger amplitude. Now, if you do the same thing in such a way that these waves are now anti-aligned, so that crests meet with troughs, you will find that there is no wave. They will cancel each other out. So this phenomena is called that the waves have met in phase to create constructive interference. The scientific term is constructive interference. On the other hand, in this case, we say that the lights or waves have met out of phase and created destructive interference, where you will see no wave. It will be very clear in the next image, this one. So what this person is sitting by a pond, and what he's doing, he has two balls and he's just oscillating it like that. So those two oscillations are creating two waves which will like propagate like this. It will flow outwards, but since there are now two waves, they will interfere with each other and create this kind of nice patterns. What you see here, these parts are called, where the amplitude is larger, are called the areas of constructive interference. And this part, these lines where you see there are no waves, those are areas of destructive interference. You can do it in a better, in a sophisticated way as well. Today we can go to your home, just pick up any question, sorry. Okay. You pick up a box, fill it with water, and then you put another cardboard in between with two slits in it, so two narrow slits. And on this side, this part which you can't see, you just use a single ball and just oscillate it like that. What it will do, it will generate these large waves, and they will propagate towards this slit. When they will hit this slit, two more waves will be generated from this part simultaneously, and they will propagate and create the same interference pattern you have seen earlier. So if you put a board here and try to draw the intensity, which is essentially the energy delivered at that point, it will look like this. So this alternate bright, dark pattern. So the bright pattern means they have interfered constructively, and the dark part means they have interfered destructively. So this is we called, but now consider if you empty out the water, and instead of water, you just directly throw balls in it. So you have balls or marbles, and you shoot marbles towards the slit. What kind of pattern do you expect to see here? Yes? Yeah. So what will happen is very simple to understand. You're throwing the balls, and the balls will either go through this left slit or right slit and hit in the background, and they will make this kind of two bands which are aligned with the point where you are throwing. So this experiment, this is called a double slit experiment. This is what distinguishes wave from light. If you see an interference pattern like this, you call the object is behaving like a wave. If you find this kind of double, just two bands, you say that the particles are, the object is behaving like particles. So this is the experiment you should do to verify whether something is wave or particle. Since I said I will take you to the quantum world, let's do the same experiment in the quantum world. So for that, what you have to do, you have to squeeze everything down. If you have to reduce the size of all the objects, essentially the board, this double slit and the board, and what we have is an electron gun. So the electron gun shoots a large amount of electrons towards this double slit, and we record the pattern on the background, on this board. Can anyone tell me what is an electron? Yes?
It's a negatively charged permanent particle that orbits around the nucleus.
Yeah, that's correct. So electrons are essentially negative charge, which move around, which is one of the constituents of the atom. They are fundamental particles which cannot be broken down into smaller pieces. So electron was discovered in 1897 by J.J. Thomson, and what was already known that electrons behave like particles. So then, since we know electrons behave like particles, what do you expect to see in the board? Yes? Two bands, right? Because electrons are like small balls. It should go through the slit and get out. But we found interference. So what happens, although electrons behave like particles, they show this interference pattern. This means they have to behave like waves. But scientists were smart. They said something must be wrong with this experiment. So they tried to figure out what is wrong. They said, well, it must be the case that you are throwing lots of electrons together. They must be bouncing off from each other and creating this pattern. Right? That's an easy explanation. So there is a simple solution to it. What about I modify my gun so that it shoots only one electron at a time? What I mean that there is enough time gap between two electrons which is shooted from the which from the gun. Then you have to repeat this experiment for a long time, and still you will find interference pattern. Now this completely mesmerized the scientists. There is no way to understand that. Electrons should behave like that. I am throwing only one electron at a time, but still I am seeing the interference pattern. How is that possible? When there is no way out, the only acceptable solution is that electron must behave like waves. And then they self-interfere. But this means that electron somehow goes through both of the slits together and interferes with itself, and then, like a wave does. And in fact, this is just not true for electrons. Scientists have verified this experiment with other quantum mechanical objects like protons, neutrons, and atoms. In all the cases, they found the same result. They always found the interference pattern. So if you use your daily language to explain this phenomenon, you have to say that electrons somehow went through both of the slits together, which means that electrons can exist simultaneously at two places. And this is the strangest part of quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanical particles can exist at two positions at the same time. And that's, I can't see the strange part. Isn't it strange? Right? So that is phenomena is quantum superposition. But it's not a myth, actually we do observe this kind of phenomena in our lab. We already deal with this kind of effect. So this is called quantum superposition. And the essential idea of this second part is that particles can exist in two positions simultaneously. And which in turn means particles can behave like waves. And the previous part, we learned that light can also behave like particles. And if you combine these two ideas, what is called wave-particle duality, which means that in microscopic world, nothing is called a wave or a particle. Everything is same. They behave like both of them. So now that we learned about the quantum superposition, let's try to understand what will happen if we use these particles to perform computation. Okay? So let's first talk about our computers, which you use every day. These are called classical computers. And can anyone tell me what kind of language they use to perform computation? Binary arithmetic, correct. So they use only zeros and ones for their computation. What we use every day in your life are called decimal representation of the number, where you use 0 to 9 and use these units to build larger numbers. But in binaries, 0 is represented as 0, 1 as 1, but for 2, there is no 2, so you have to express 2 using 1 and zeros. So you have to add 1 to this digit. But so 1, if you add 1 to 1, it gives 0, and you have a carry on, which is another 1. So you get 1, 0. Similarly, for 3, you add up another 1, get 1, 1, for 4, 100, and so on. It's not just true for numbers, even for letters. For example, A in binary form is represented by this expression. And our all favorite at the rate symbol have 1 and 6 zeros. So all the images you take with your mobile phones, record the sounds, take a video, Everything is converted into this binary form before they are written in your computer's hard drive or other storage media like USB drive or CD drives. What computers use for their computation are called transistors. These are the elementary blocks which act like a switch. They have two stages, like one high voltage state and another low voltage state. If the transistor is in its high voltage state, it is said to be in on position and represented as 1. This is binary 1. If it is in its low voltage state, then it's said to be in off position, and that is represented by 0. But now you see, there is nothing. There are always either 1 or 0. They are either on or off. There is nothing like on and off simultaneously. You can't even think about that. What do you mean by on and off simultaneously? So in classical computation, you have bits, and they exist either in 0 or 1, not both of them together. But now what about the quantum mechanical particles? I showed the experiment, double slit experiment. So the quantum equivalent of a classical bit is called a qubit. Similarly, it will be a system which will have two states, which you will label at 0 and 1. For example, in the double slit experiment I showed you, if the electron went through the left slit, we could call it 0. And if the electron went through the right slit, we could call it 1. Scientists in quantum computation use a slightly different notation to distinguish from values 0 and 1 to state 0 and 1. So they use this kind of special notation to mean that this is state 0 and state 1 and not values 0 and 1. Okay? But now, in quantum mechanics, we know superposition exists, which means 0 and 1 can be existing simultaneously, 0 and 1 together. So that's the essential difference between your classical bit and quantum bit. In quantum bit, you can have 0 and 1 together, whereas in classical bit, you will have either 0 or 1. So let's now try to visualize these qubits. Okay? So here I have drawn a sphere like Earth, which have North Pole, South Pole, and equator. Then an arrow pointing the north could be represented as 0. An arrow pointing the South Pole can be represented as 1. So these two points, North Pole and South Pole, can be thought as those classical states, 0 and 1. And any other state on this sphere are superposition states, like the one pointing towards the equator. So I would like to emphasize that qubits are not arrows pointing in space. It's just a way of visualization there. Okay? So if you want to take a more realistic example, let's consider that I have a qubit inside this box. Okay? You can think in a real life, this is a complete experimental setup. To find the state of the qubit, we open the box. Or in the lab, you can say we have performed a measurement on the qubit, which means that you have to dial several knobs, press some buttons, and eventually you get some result on your computer monitor. So in case of qubits, whenever you perform this kind of experiment, you will get only two values, either 0 or 1, like a classical case. You will not get any other value. You will get always either 0 or 1. If you get 0, then you say that, okay, after the measurement, the state of my qubit is 0, or you can now think this as an arrow pointing up. On the other hand, if you had find it the value to be 1, you say that the state of my qubit is 1, and then an arrow pointing downwards. It's true reverse on the other way as well. You could, if you now, instead of saying that I found the value 0, and hence the state is 0, it's true reversibly. What I mean by that, even if you prepare the state in 0 and do a measurement, you will find the value to be 0. And similarly, if you prepare the qubit in 1 and do a measurement, you will find the value to be 1. Is that clear? Yes?
Yes.
OK. So now the question is, what about this state? What about I prepare a qubit in this kind of superposition state and do the measurement? What will we see? Can anyone tell me what will we see? Sorry? Either 0 or 1. That's correct. So because this superposition state contains both 0 and 1, we perform the measurement, you'll sometimes find 0, and you'll find 1. There is nothing called 0 and 1 together. You will always end up getting 0 or 1. But now if you repeat the experiment again and again, always prepare in this state and perform a measurement, let's say you have done it in a million of times, what you'll eventually find that 50% of the times you found the qubit to be in 0, and 50% of times you found the qubit to be in 1. So now this arrow helps in visualization. Again, I say that this is not the actual qubit. So what this means that you can think that, okay, I know the North Pole is like 0 and the South Pole is like 1. So this arrow is like equally distant from both of them. That's why I ended up getting 50% of 0 and 50% of 50% of time it went back and you found it here, and 50% of time you jumped here and you found it 1. OK, What about other superposition states, like the arrow showed here? Anyone? anyone else? Yeah, that's correct. So because now the arrow is more closer to the north pole, you expect if you again do the same thing, prepare this state and do a measurement, majority of the times you will find this to be in 0, and some of the times you will find it to be in 1. Let's consider an example. Let's say you found 75% of the times to be in 0 and 25% of the times to be in 1. So now you see there are infinitely many possibilities to create superposition states, right? So we need a mathematical description. Don't freak out, it's a very simple description. We need a mathematical description to represent these states. So a general state is written as A0 plus B1. We know it's a combination of 0 and 1, that's why there are 0 and 1. We write a plus sign in between. And we put some coefficient A and B to determine this kind of probability. So A and B essentially tells you what is the probability of finding it in the north pole or south pole. In fact, probability of finding it in 0 is A square, and probability of finding it 1 is B square. Now you see it's very easy to write the state of this superposition. So since the probability is A square, so A square is 75% or 0.75, so A should be square root of 0.75. So this is my state. Square root of 0.75, 0, plus square root of 0.25, 1. Isn't it simple? Simple, right? OK. So can anyone now tell me what should be the state of this arrow, which is pointing towards the equator? Yes? Yeah, that's correct. Because we know this is a 50% chance of being in both the states. So we write it as square root of 0.50 plus square root of 0.51. So, if you don't like those numbers, there is a neat way to write it. 1 over square root of 0 plus 1 over square root of 1. It's essentially the same thing. 1 over square root of 2 means square root of half, which is square root of 0.5. This is some special kind of superposition state, and we write it in this way. So, now that you have learned about a single qubit, let's talk about two qubits. Let's say I have qubit 1 in the state A0 plus B1, and qubit 2 is also in the same state A0 plus B1, but I have used blue and red color to distinguish that this is qubit 1 and qubit 2. Let's consider the classical case. If you had like bit 1 and bit 2, let's say both of them are 0, then to represent the combined system, you just write it side by side, 0, 0. Let's do the same thing to represent the combined qubit, two qubit system. So the full two qubit system can be written as A0 plus B1 and A0 plus B1 side by side. So in mathematics, we call it to take product. We are taking product of these two states. So for mathematical simplicity, I'll drop out this coefficient AB because the physics is essentially the same. So I'll just write it as 0 plus 1 and 0 plus 1. Now we can take the product, right? What should we have? Yeah. So we'll have all the combinations. So 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, and 1, 0, all of them. Now this starts looking slightly more strange. This is a two-qubit superposition state, by the way. So consider, contrast it with the two-bit. If you had just two bits, you would have either 0, 0, or 1, 1, or 0, 1, or 1, 0. Only one of them at a time, not you cannot have both of all of these together. But in quantum mechanical case, you have all of them together. And that gives the quantum qubits, the qubit superiority over the classical bits. Because now you think that you want to perform an operation on these bits. For example, consider a function which just flips the first qubit. If it's 0, it makes it to 1. If it's 1, it makes it 0. In the classical case, to find the result of this function, you have to operate this 4 times for these all 4 possibilities, one at a time. But in a quantum mechanical case, because they exist in superposition form, you can operate that function in that and all the results will be carried out at once, simultaneously. So this is the parallelism which comes in the quantum world. In quantum computation, you have inherent parallelism. So I'm talking about just two qubits. What about three qubits? If I had three, you will have 2 into 2 into 2 equal to 8 possible states. For 4 qubits, you will have 16 possible states. And you see the number grows very rapidly. If you have n qubits, you will have 2 to the power n states, 2 into 2 into 2 up to n times. And all the superpositions, all the states together in this superposition form. If you want to have a feeling of how large this number can be, you know how many transistors are there in a computer? Can anyone tell me? Let's say order of magnitude. How many are there, roughly? Actually, yeah, few billions, right? Just now consider 100 qubits, 100. So this number is 2 to the power 100. And this number is so large that it's greater than the number of total atoms in the visible universe. If you want to count the number of atoms in the visible universe, this number is even larger than that. So now you see the power. So if you create just a superposition state of 100 qubits, you can do infinite amount of quantum computation just in a single run. Whereas for the classical bit, you have to do each of them individually, one by one, one after another. So for n qubits, you have all of the 2 to the power n states together, but for n classical bit, you have just one of them. And that gives you the superiority over classical computing. Okay, so you have understood now the quantum superposition part and how this superposition idea can be used in computation and give you superior result. And we'll take a break here for chai and then meet after a few minutes. Right?
I think it was.
Okay, so the people who came late, I'll just give you a brief summary. What we have learned till now is that quantum superposition, which means particle can exist at, particles can exist at two points simultaneously. We saw that particles can behave like waves. We also saw that waves or light can also behave like particles. If you combine the two effect, it's called wave-particle duality. Then we learned to visualize the qubits and how to measure them and how the quantum bits are superior to the classical case. Okay, let's move on and ask a slightly different question. Again, consider a two-qubit system and I have written the full state here. So if I give you this state and ask you the reverse question, what is the state of the qubit 1 and qubit 2? Anyone? Yes?
1 and 0.
1 and 0? You saw in the previous slide, right? I wrote A0 plus B1, A0 plus, and I did the product state, which turned out to be this. So it's the reverse problem. I have given you this state, and you can write it as product of two states, which are 0 plus 1 and 0 plus 1, which means the qubit is 1 is in 0 plus 1 and qubit 2 is also in 0 plus 1. What does it mean from the perspective of measurement? I have now two qubits, so I have put two boxes here, and I open one box, I prepare this state, open one box, and try to perform measurement. What do you see? Yeah, we'll see 0 and 1s because we know this is a superposition state. 50% of the time we'll see 0 and 1. So sometimes we'll get 0, sometimes we'll get 1. Similarly, the same will happen for the qubit 2 as well because that is also in the same state. Sometimes we'll get 0 and 1. So because these two processes are kind of independent or random, what will happen eventually, if you record all the outcomes, you'll end up getting all four possibilities, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, and 1, 0. Now talk about a different kind of state. I talked about superposition states, right? I showed that it's not always required to be like 50%, 50%. They can come in different ratios. For example, 75% and 25%. And that is also true for a two-qubit system. So what I have four possible states here, and I can choose any combination, any proportion from that. I can choose 40% of this, 40% of 1, 10% of this, and 10% of that. Let's take it further. We'll take only these two, 50% of this and 50% of that, and none of these two. Okay? So the state will now look like 0, 0 plus 1, 1. Let's give it a name. We call it a build state. Okay? And I ask you the same question again. What is the state of these two qubits? Well, now you see it's kind of weird, because initially in this first case, you could write it in product form. I could say, OK, this is my state. But in this case, you cannot write it in a product form. There's nothing like something into something. You cannot write it like that. So you cannot simply describe the state of individual qubits. Okay? You can only describe it as a combined system. Let's try to understand what happens in this case if we perform measurements. Okay? In the previous case, I told you, if we perform measurement, we get all these four possibilities. But let's try to see what happens here. So again, I have two boxes. I tell you that I have a method which I can create, using which I can create this build state. Okay? So I open the left box. Let's say I found it to be 0. Then I open the right box, and I also found it to be 0. Then I recorded it. OK, I found 0, 0. Let's repeat the experiment again. Prepare the qubit in this state and measure. Let's say this time you found 1, 1. And you kept a record, 0, 0 and 1, 1. Now again, you repeat the experiment again and again. What you will see that in this case, you always found 0, 0 and 1, 1, no matter what you do. You can repeat this experiment millions of times. You can open the left box first, or you can open the right box first. You can open both of them together. Nothing changes the outcome. You always get 0, 0 and 1, 1, and never 0 and 1, 0. Well, this kind of sounds strange. This tells you that I have two qubits. The outputs are random. You don't know a priori whether it's going to be 0 or 1. But as soon as you open one box and found to be 0, somehow the second box comes to know that, OK, my friend has become 0, so I have to also become 0. Or if this one becomes 1, this becomes 1. So it looks like some kind of influence is going there from here to the other qubit. So all the physicists tried to observe that. They couldn't detect any influence is going there. So they thought that, OK, maybe some interaction is going on which we can't detect. But what was known by Einstein's theory of relativity, that nothing can travel faster than light. No information can be sent faster than light. So what they did a smart experiment. So what they did, they again prepared the two qubit in this state, took one box, put it in a spaceship, and sent it to the other side of our galaxy. Okay? So it's a hypothetical situation, not they have really sent. So now the two qubits are in the opposite ends of our galaxy. And do you know what's the diameter of our galaxy, Milky Way? Yeah, that's correct. It's 100,000 light years, which means if you send light from one end, it will take 100,000 years to reach the other end. Okay? So they are very vast distance apart. Now you repeat the same experiment. You open the boxes. This time you open the boxes simultaneously. So what you have done, you have taken a watch which is in sync with a watch in the Earth, put it in the spaceship, and you have already decided, OK, at 11 a.m. we'll perform one measurement, and 11:05 a.m. we'll perform another measurement, and so on. And what you found, that's again the same result, 0, 0 plus 1, 1. And scientists are completely baffled by this idea. They had no clue what is going on. You know, these things are light years apart. There is no way that information can go this to this point instantaneously. But still, they find this correlation, always 0, 0 or 1, 1. And in fact, Einstein was very unhappy with this. And this thing, he said, spooky action at a distance. Or in German, it sounds even more strange, spukhafte Fernwirkung. OK? So this is the irony. Einstein was the very first person who took the idea of Max Planck in 1905, explained the photoelectric effect, got the Nobel Prize for that. And later in his life, he couldn't believe in it because the outcomes were so strange. It looks like one particle influences the other instantaneously. Information is traveling faster than light. Okay? So let's come back to the old problem, that what is the state of qubits individually here. So you see, there is no way to explain the state as an individual qubit. You have to use this kind of phrase. If the qubit is qubit 1 is 0, then the qubit is 0. If the qubit if the first qubit is 0, then the second qubit is 0. If the first qubit is 1, then the second qubit is 1. There is no simple explanation of the state of one qubit. So what this means that the qubits have lost their individuality, and you can only explain in some kind of correlation, okay? So this is the strangest observation of quantum mechanics. These kind of special states are called entangled state, and the process of making them is called entanglement. There are many other entangled states, but it's not that there's just theoretical idea. We do observe these states in our lab, okay? So, by the way, it is a common misconception that using entanglement, you will be able to send information faster than light, because it looks like whenever I observe it and found it to be one, the other side also becomes instantaneously one. But that's not true, because you know this outcome is random. You don't know a priori what is going to be. It could be either 0 or 1. And similarly, the other side will be 0 or 1. Since it's random, you cannot use that technique to send information. Okay? So entanglement doesn't violate the Einstein's general relativity, that information cannot be transferred faster than light. So it's just a digression from this all the whole talk. There are a few games available which uses the idea of quantum mechanics. For example, quantum chess, where now these different pieces can exist in superposition or entangled states. For example, you can see this rook here, and also the knights, bishops, they are in superposition state, and this one, the knight here is in actually entangled state, because there is no conjugate of this. So you see, there is half probability of finding this rook here and half probability of finding this here. Similarly, for this one, here half and here half, but there is no counterpart of this. Actually, that's an entangled state. So I'll not go to the details of this. This is available online, but I think you have to pay. This is not free yet. Anyway, so now that we have learned about quantum superposition and the most strange thing, quantum entanglement, let's try to see what can we do, what kind of enhancement we can do in computation using these two strange phenomena to build a quantum computer. Before showing how to build a quantum computer, I will first tell you what kind of problems they can solve. Okay? The first one is traveling salesman problem. It's very, all of us do online shopping. So in the morning, a Flipkart delivery boy has to give, let's say, he has to deliver six parcels at six positions. Okay? So he is smart. He knows the distances between all these positions, and he wants to calculate what is the shortest path available so that I can deliver all my parcels and come back to my original position, starting position. So it turns out that classical computers are not very good at solving this problem. Although you can say, well, I can use a brute force approach, I can take all the possibilities and just find the minimum value. In case of six places, there are just 720 possibilities. You can solve it easily. But it grows very quickly. In just for 10 places, the number of possible routes is more than 3 million. So you see, if the now Flipkart guy starts to solve this problem in the morning, he will end up using his whole day and will not be able to deliver any of the parcels. But in fact, quantum computer can do this very easily. Another problem is searching unsorted data. In old days, we used to have this kind of phone books, which used to be sorted alphabetically, right? So you can go find some person's name and find his number. What if I give you the reverse problem? I tell you I'm giving you the number in the number and ask you find the owner of that number. Now you see it's very difficult because you have to go through all the entries. If you are very lucky, you will find it in the first page, but if you are unlucky, you have to go through the very end of the book. If you repeat this experiment, but repeat this finding procedure again and again, sometimes you will find it before going searching half of the book, sometimes you will find after half of the book. So on average, if there are n entries in that book, you have to look for n by 2 times, right? But an Indian scientist named Love Grover in 1996 came up with an algorithm called, which is famous as Grover's search algorithm. By algorithm, I mean a set of rules which you lead to solution of a specific problem. So his algorithm can solve this problem very quickly. How quickly? N by 2 versus square root of n. So if you have 1 million entries in that book, n by 2 means 500,000 times you have to make a query. On the other hand, square root of n means just 1,000 queries. In 1,000 queries, you will be able to find that person. So that's pretty good advantage. And what quantum computers are very good at is something problems related to prime factorization. So let's play a game first. Okay? I'll give you a number, and you have to tell me the product factors of that. 10. Yeah. Correct, 2 into 5, 77.
77.
Good. 133. Yes, 790. So people who are very good at number tables, they will quickly find out. 589. So you see the point, right? As the numbers is growing, it becomes difficult, more difficult to solve that problem, to find these factors. It's not just true for humans. It's actually also true for computers. But some of you might be very smart. You might have an app in your mobile phone, and it will quickly compute it and tell me it's 19 into 31. What about this number? This is an 18-digit number, and it's very unlikely that your mobile phone will be solve this, will be able to solve this problem. So you have to use a computer. So anyway, prime factorization is a difficult problem, and it's more difficult for this special kind of numbers, which are called semi-prime numbers. You know, prime numbers are those which don't have divisors other than 1 and itself, okay, like this, 2, 5, 7, 11, 19. And when you use just two primes to find a product, so these numbers are called semi-prime numbers. So 1 here is actually a semi-prime number. So it's, you see, this is the correct result, which if you can solve it using a computer, but it's very hard to find this result. On the other hand, if I give you these two numbers and ask you to check whether this is correct or not, you will do it right in front of me in the blackboard. So it's very easy in that direction, but it's very difficult in the other direction. So there are other certain class of problems which is very difficult in one direction but easy in the other. So prime factorization is one of them. So to give you more feel about how complicated these are, let's consider a 100-digit number, okay? You have a 100-digit semi-prime number. You can solve it, try to find the factors in your modern computer. It will take about 1 hour to solve it. If I just increase just 20 more digits, 120-digit semi-prime, it will take 4 months to solve that problem. In fact, the latest number that people have found is that record is called a number which is named as RSS768, and it's a 232-digit number, pretty long. I can show you in the end if you want how it looks like. How people factor it out? They used several computer clusters in different part of the globe to solve that, to find the factors. And effectively, it took, if you wanted to solve in a single computer, it would take 2,000 years to solve that problem. So finally, if I give you a 1,000-digit number, this is 10 to the power 24 years. The problem becomes increased exponentially complicated or complex, hard to solve if you increase the number of digits. So this number is so large, it is larger than the age of current universe. Which means that if you use all the computers available in the world, eventually they will die trying to solve that problem. They will not be able to do it. And MIT physicist named Peter Shor found out a quantum algorithm. And that algorithm, if you can run on a quantum computer, can solve it in just 20 seconds. So you see how incredibly more powerful quantum computers are compared to your classical computers, okay? There are a few other applications like simulate chemical reactions, because chemical compounds are essentially quantum mechanical, and you can simulate them easily using a quantum computer. Design better drugs, which will give you better medical medicines. And there are some other problems called optimization problems. For example, image detection. You know, Google is trying to deliver a driverless car, which mainly uses image detection, traffic control, and accurate weather prediction, which needs vast amount of data to be analyzed. So anyway, so these are the applications of quantum computer. What about, is there a quantum computer right now in the world? The answer is no and yes. So no, because there is no fully full-fledged quantum computer which can run this kind of algorithms, which I showed earlier. But still, there are prototypes. I'm going to show a few possible implementations. I'm not going to talk in detail. There will be another Chai and Hui in first week of December, which will talk about detailed implementations. I'll show you just quickly some images. So this is what is called trapped ion system. These are ions which are trapped in an electromagnetic field and can be used as qubits. This is called quantum dots, very tiny circuits. Nitrogen vacancies in diamonds. So people do research with diamonds as well, not only used for jewelry. Superconducting currents and superconducting qubits. In TIFR, we use superconducting qubits. These are essentially circuits, electrical circuits, drawn on a silicon chip. Okay? These are few prototypes. In TIFR, we have a 3-qubit system. The UCSB, University of California Santa Barbara group, which is now owned by Google, have a 9-qubit processor, and IBM has a 5-qubit processor. All of them have their own advantages and disadvantages. Okay, they cannot solve all the problems, but some of the problems they can. We have a processor in which we can do some computation, but you see there are only 3 qubits, so you can't do much. We are trying to build more, actually. But what IBM has done, they have taken this thing one step further. They have put their processor online. This is called IBM Quantum Experience. You can just Google it and register with them, and you will be able to use their processor. So this is a cloud-based quantum computing environment, and it's currently open to public. Okay? So you have to go through several tutorials to understand how these quantum qubits behave, and then you will be writing your own circuit algorithm like this, the one I have written here. So there are 5 qubits, and these blocks are essentially different operations on those qubits, which will eventually lead to some result. Okay? So, showing that, what we have learned today, first thing we learned is energy is quantized, light comes in packets, and not continuous. We learned about wave-particle duality, which means waves can behave like particles, and particles also can behave like waves in a quantum mechanical world. We learned about superposition states, where a single quantum mechanical object can exist at 2 places simultaneously. Then entanglement, this weird state where 2 qubits lost their individual identity and gives rise to some strange phenomena, which Einstein called spooky action at a distance. But it's true, it actually happens. And I showed you a few prototypes. But I believe that in next 30, 40 years, we'll have much better quantum computer. Of course, not in your desktops, but similarly in a cloud-based system, so you will be able to solve hard problems. So after this talk, looking at you, I can tell you probably the state of this audience is 1/√ of you have understood quantum mechanics, and 1/√, you haven't understood quantum mechanics. But don't worry. Once a famous scientist called Richard Feynman said, if you think you understand quantum mechanics, you don't understand quantum mechanics. Okay. Thank you.
Tanay, to make this thing palatable for all ages, thanks, and actually there have been some remarks from few parents and few veterans of this program, not from our side, from the audience side. There have been few patrons who have been coming from day one, and they said, Suren, is this the largest audience that you have got, and the largest bill you have made for the Chai in Rupertville College? I said, yes. In fact, yes, if you were not here in such large numbers, yeah, I would have paid half the amount of money. So thanks for coming in large numbers. Keep coming, because we are trying to get things as interesting, and as science is advancing, we will have more tools to explore our surroundings and probably come up with better quality things. And there was a parent who said, "Arey, my son had stuck with this program, and he was, unable to keep himself away from this program, though it was running so heavily when we started. But never mind, we came. And yes, keep coming. If you can get a few more youngsters interested, the last remark from Tanay was, maybe in next 30-40 years, we'll be seeing things in a totally different perspective. Yes, it is about to change. Almost 4 years back, the stars were there, they were twinkling all the time that the Earth has been around, and somebody invented the lenses, but then somebody else turned it to the skies, and here we are today. Even India, which was supposed to be an underdog to the most of the world till about 1980s, we have made far more advances than they could have even imagined, and even we could have dreamt of. Like, you know, today we are a technologically more advanced place than most of the other countries, and let's hope that we can have this kind of logic built up into our own psyche and systems, that we can come up much better and make a better society of our own nation. So I think the floor is open for any questions. As much as we can, we'll try to do it, cover it up in next 30-40 minutes, whatever we have at our disposal. If you cannot get your answer, there is a possibility that Tanay, he is a student at our lab, and there is a possibility that we have some understanding limitations and things. Don't undermine his ability. What you can do is just send us the questions through the email at outreach@tifr.res.in. We'll pose it to, you know, more seniors and get you the answers if possible again. Yeah.